Or glands do.
Control the metabolic activity.
Metabolism.
All right, they control metabolism of all body organs, correct? So here they release three. T3, T4, and then calcitonin. T3, T4 increase metabolism. So if you have an overproduction of T3, T4, then your metabolism is high. And then if you don't have enough T3, T4, then your metabolism rate drops. Calcitonin is the third hormone. The only job of calcitonin is to decrease calcium levels. The parathyroid glands, which are attached to the thyroid glands, increase calcium levels by producing the parathyroid hormone. And therefore, the negative feedback there is in the thyroid gland, which is calcitonin. So what do you look like if you have hyperthyroidism? So imagine someone with a really high metabolic rate. So this would be a very jittery, hyperactive, restless person you can see. Again, with the skin. So this affects all cells, okay? From your head to the toe. So every single cell in your body has a very high metabolic rate, which would explain these skin changes here. Because all your, including your hair follicles, they are so hyperactive. Your sweat glands are so hyperactive, so you have these symptoms here. Cardiopulmonary systems, the main complications here are either you'll have a hypertensive crisis or even a myocardial infarction. You could also have severe tachycardia. GI, you'll have diarrhea. As a result, you lose weight because you're always going to the bathroom. This is despite having an increased appetite, meaning even if the patient, let's say, eats so much because they have a good appetite, they will never gain weight. Instead, they will keep losing weight as fast as they are eating, meaning it's impossible for them to meet their metabolic demands even if they eat nonstop. The most prominent is the protrusion of the eyeballs, or at least the eyeballs look like they're popping out of the socket. This is actually more of an illusion, because there is eyelid retraction and as well as eyelid lag. So if you guys try pulling your eyelids back, it will actually give you a startled look. Okay, so you look like your eyes are popping out if you retract your eyelid. There is insomnia. Because of your high metabolic rate, so you'll always have a low-grade fever. You'll be sweating a lot, and as already mentioned, because you cannot ingest enough food to keep up with your metabolic rate, so this will result in fatigue. You'll also have rapid mood swings, so you'll have emotional instability, so you'll go from one spectrum of your mood, you know, from a really low to a really high mood, and then back again. Reproductive symptoms, you'll have amenorrhea, so you'll have problems conceiving. This disease, by the way, starts at around 20 years old, sometimes a little bit less. So it does affect women of childbearing age. So this could be a problem. And here are other symptoms not otherwise falling under those mentioned above. The enlarged spleen here is because of the increased activity of blood cell production as well. So therefore, the blood cells may end up dying soon also. And all blood cells that are that have outlived their lifespans are all recycled in the spleen, resulting in enlargement. So the explanation of chart 62, 63, 61 are in the next paragraph. I encourage you to read it on your own. So here's the weight loss, because you're pretty much eating yourself up. So you go into a negative nitrogen balance. Hyperglycemia also increases because of a direct consequence of the increased metabolic rate. The most common form is Graves' disease. Bear in mind that Graves' disease is primary hyperthyroidism. There is a secondary form, which is not a thyroid gland problem. This instead is a pituitary gland problem. So I'll leave this 1265. Somebody remind me of that page number. Let me go back to 61. Actually, it's in 62, sorry. Yeah, it makes sense. It's in 62 because it's under hyperpituitarism. Okay, here. Here you have a this is labeled under pituitary hypofunction, but let's just do the opposite. So if you have a hypoactive pituitary gland, and one of the hormones produced by the pituitary gland is, of course, the thyroid stimulating hormone, correct? Mm-hmm. So if you have a
Professor, what page is this on?
This is in 62.
1246.
All right, so let's take it from the top. So this table is describing a hypoactive pituitary gland. Pituitary gland, one of the hormones is the thyroid stimulating hormone. Therefore, if the pituitary gland is hypoactive, therefore, the thyroid stimulating hormone levels that it's supposed to produce is low. That's why you'll have signs and symptoms of hypothyroidism. In contrast, if you have a hyperactive pituitary, or we call that hyperpituitarism, so therefore, what happens to your TSH level if you have a hyperactive pituitary gland?
Does it increase?
That okay. Increase the thyroid stimulating hormone.
So TSH will be high. What symptoms will you see here? Symptoms of hypothyroidism or symptoms of hyperthyroidism?
Opposite to that, intolerance.
Hyperthyroidism.
Okay, so we'll have hyperthyroidism. Okay, so hold that thought for a minute. Okay, and then let's go back to 63 under hyperthyroidism, under primary hyperthyroidism. So in 62, the problem there is the pituitary gland itself, whereas in chapter 63, the defective gland here is the thyroid gland. When we look at the laboratory profile, so look at column number 3. So this is hyperthyroidism. And then let's compare it with hyperpituitarism. Obviously, serum T3, T4 are high because you have a hyperactive thyroid gland. Mm-hmm. So it's your 3T4. Look at your TSH down here. So it is low in Graves' disease and then high in secondary hyperthyroidism is resulting from hyperpituitarism. Okay, so I just want you to be aware of this distinction here, because there can be a primary and a secondary hyperthyroidism, just like there is a primary and a secondary hyperthyroidism. So you just do the opposite. So here in hyperthyroidism, in primary, the problem here is the thyroid gland. It is incapable of regulating the production of T3, T4. The thyroid gland in this instance has a very high production of T3, T4. So therefore, since our body, specifically the endocrine system, works by negative feedback, so if it's already high, T3, T4 are already high, what will the pituitary gland do in primary hyperthyroidism? Will it still stimulate the thyroid gland to produce more T3,
T4?
So therefore, right here, in Graves' disease, your TSH level will drop. However, if it's a pituitary problem causing the hyperthyroidism, which is now called secondary hyperthyroidism, it is actually already high. Okay, because in secondary, what's causing the hyperthyroidism isn't the thyroid gland. It's the pituitary gland causing
the pituitary gland, yeah.
Yeah, does that make sense? Any questions, Clarice?
So, Professor, you mean to say what's the action of pituitary gland in the primary and secondary, right?
Yeah. Remember that the pituitary gland is the master gland, correct? So, therefore, mm-hmm. it has influence on all of the body's endocrine glands, including the thyroid glands. So there's two possible causes of hyperthyroidism here. It can be primary, which is Graves' disease is the most common type, or it can be secondary, which is now all caused by a hyperpituitary disorder.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so the main difference here is in the TSH level in both. Is that clear?
Yes.
Awesome. Let's go to... please read the rest of the paragraph on signs and symptoms. I already read 62-1 for you. Let's discuss goiter. Thank you for reading, Ms. Sundberg.
Goiters are common in Graves' disease and are classified by size. Not all patients with goiter have hyperthyroidism.
All right, so both problems here can have goiter, meaning goiter isn't just seen in hyperthyroidism. And in the same note, not all patients who have hyperthyroidism will also have goiter, okay? So let's discuss goiters when they do appear. In the case of hyperthyroidism, it's very obvious. The reason is obvious. You have a very hyperactive thyroid gland. So therefore, because of its hyperactivity, the cells will hypertrophy or increase in size because of their activity. Therefore, goiter will form. In the case of hypothyroidism, though, there is also goiter. But in the case of hypothyroidism, it's because of the extremely high TSH level. Let's go back to the lab. So here under hypothyroidism, because their T3, T4s are so low, it's decreased, T3, T4, even free T4 is decreased. So therefore, that will stimulate the release of TSH from the pituitary gland. And as high as the TSH goes, so therefore it stands for thyroid stimulating hormone, correct? So therefore it will force the thyroid glands to produce more T3, T4. But because it's not capable of doing so, the T3, T4 levels remain low in hypothyroidism. However, because of the increased stimulation from the TSH levels, then that's the reason why there is also goiter in hypothyroidism. Any question on that? Why there is goiter in both?
Can you go over one more time why the high TSH levels would cause the goiter to enlarge?
Okay, in hypothyroidism. Okay, so it's like the analogy is, let's say I keep pushing you to work out. Let's say it's the lockdown and you're stuck in your house, you're not doing anything. Okay, and then I'm the TSH. So I'll keep pushing you to, hey, come on, get up. No, exercise, go do some push-ups. Yeah, you're tired? No, get up. You're not tired. Go get up, do some more. What? You can't do it anymore? No. Go get up. Go do some more exercises. So what will happen to you if you're forced to work even though there is no productivity? Meaning you'll try to work, but you're still unable.
Okay.
So there's the constant stimulation. However, there is no resulting output. That's the case in hypothyroidism. Okay, that's why it leads to goiter or the enlargement of the thyroid gland.
Okay,
thank you. So here, I stated here, the thyroid glands are normally not palpable. If you guys palpate yours, you shouldn't feel it. All you'll feel there is your trachea. Okay, so the cricoid cartilage there, you can palpate, but it's impossible to palpate the thyroid glands, okay, under normal conditions. However, when enlarged, it's not only palpable, but very, very visible. Let's go now to diagnostic testing. There are two radioactive iodines being used. It depends on the amount. So one used for diagnostic purposes is called radioactive iodine 123. The therapeutic one is a higher dose, which is now RAI 131. 123 is used simply for diagnostic purposes. So this is done through a thyroid scan. So they'll expose you, they'll either give you PO, or sometimes this is also injected, but most of the time it's given by mouth. So it's a liquid preparation. So you take it and then you go for a thyroid scan. So it will show how much of your thyroid gland will absorb the radioactive iodine. So therefore, if more of it is absorbed, then of course that will mean it's not normal anymore. It's hyperactive, because normally this is the expected result. If it's normal, only 5 to 35% of it will be absorbed by the thyroid glands. However, if more than 35%, 50% or up to 100% is taken up by the thyroid glands, then of course they have a very hyperactive thyroid glands. Ultrasounds will give you a visual picture. ECGs will simply show, it won't diagnose hyperthyroidism, but it will show cardiovascular effects of the hyperthyroidism, meaning has it already caused any cardiovascular problems? It may have already caused heart failure, okay? Or at least hypertension. Interventions. The patient will eventually need surgery. But if you remember also from chapter 62, we can't just have surgery right away, correct? You saw that in Cushing's syndrome, or I mean Cushing's disease. Before they had surgery, we gave them preparations, correct? We gave them glucocorticoid preparations before, during, and after surgery. Same thing here. In Graves' disease, because the thyroid gland is already so hyperactive, and if it's swollen like this, look at this picture. If the thyroid glands are that big and you do surgery, what made them that big, by the way, first of all? Why are they so large?
Because of the thyroid stimulating hormone, excess of T3 and T4.
Well, that's what's causing it to enlarge. But physically, I mean, what would cause it to enlarge like that, physiologically?
Hypertrophied thyroid cells or something like that?
Actually, it's the same as it's the same concept as a penis getting an erection. So why would a penis enlarge during an erection?
Blood flow.
Increased blood flow.
Actually, the blood flow. So think of it as the thyroid glands getting a really huge erection, right? So is it safe to perform surgery during that state? What will happen if we do surgery at that particular state that the thyroid glands are so big, so rich with blood flow?
They could bleed out.
There will be extreme bleeding. There will be massive bleeding if we do that. So surgery is the permanent cure. We will have to decrease the size first. So we have interventions first. Let's go here. Let's talk about this because surgery is mentioned after non-surgical management. So let's start with this first. Just like in Addison's and Cushing's, wherein you have a crisis, right? You have an emergency. In hyperthyroidism, you also have one. It's called thyroid storm. So this is a really rapid onset of all those symptoms listed in chart 62-1. So we're talking about massive, severe hypertension here. High fever, severe hypertension. And as a result, you also have increased heart rate. The patient could have seizures as a result because of the severe hypertension. And these are the two cardinal signs of a thyroid storm. It doesn't take much. Please, if a patient's admitted for hyperthyroidism, and you know that hospitalization in itself is already stressful, correct? Because the number one trigger of thyroid storm is stress. And we already recognized last week that stress doesn't just come emotionally or physically. It's also trauma, infection, and surgery. Okay, those are all stress. So since stress is the trigger for a thyroid storm, so therefore you treat it early. So once you have an increase of 1 degree, so let's say from 37 to 38 Celsius, for instance, then your first action is always call a physician. If you're wrong, so what? No, but the important thing here is you prevent thyroid storm in the first place, or you treat early if identified. Please be specific because we can delegate this task, right, of monitoring vital signs to a UAP, but you have to be specific about what you want them to report to you. So this is an example. So tell the UAP to report a rise in temperature to you as soon as it is obtained. Meaning you don't just say, okay, can you tell me if they're going into thyroid storm, please? Yeah, thank you. Right, so you have to be specific because remember the UAP is not trained to identify thyroid storm, but they are trained to see changes in vital signs. So just be specific about what you want them to report to you. Part of prevention is, of course, they should be on a cardiac monitor. Reducing stimulation. How do you do this? Where would you put the patient on the unit? Which room would be the best? A, close to the nurse's station.
Private room.
As far away from the nurse's station as possible. C, near an exit. D, a room with blacked out windows and waterproof, fireproof, and bulletproof windows.
Close to the nurses.
D. If you choose close to the nurses station, that would be good for monitoring, right? But as far as a quiet environment,
we'll choose the blacked out room.
Is the room closest to the station?
Quiet,
quietest room?
No.
Oh, so
because of the call bells and the conversations going on.
All right. So
a lot of stimulation.
Plus nurses, you know, gossiping at the station because that's what's happening. And that's actually one of the motivation for you to come to work, you know, because if you don't come to work, you'll miss the gossip. The answer here is to put the station as far away from the station as possible, but just make sure you have the call bell and then you check on them frequently, though. Please keep the noise down as much as possible. The lighting should be dimmed. All right, so draw the curtains because we really don't have blacked out hospital windows. We have curtains. You can close the window or blinds. Okay, and then promoting comfort because there is heat intolerance here. These patients will be wearing tank tops or even naked in the middle of winter. That's how hot they feel. So I have a feeling that the naked cowboy on Times Square, that guy probably has hyperthyroidism, although it doesn't show. He's good built. Okay. Cool showers, and then we'll talk about more about eye protection because of the exophthalmos. Remember, there is eye attraction here, so they cannot completely close their eyes, exposing it to injury. So you could have corneal tears, eye drying. So we'll look at specific interventions after surgery on how to take care of the eyeball. Drug therapy now. So this is done before surgery. So we have two drugs, actually three. No, two, because there are two thionamides, and then we have a saturated solution of potassium iodide. Okay. So there are two thionamides. We have PTU or propyl thiouracil and methimazole. Please read again. This is a drug chart. So which is testable part of any drug chart? Always the nursing responsibilities. What do you teach the patient? What do you tell the patient to report? What do you monitor for these patients? Please distinguish between expected and unexpected. For instance, this one. It will cause darkening of the urine. Why? What is the significance of a darkening of the urine or yellowing of the skin?
It's hepatotoxic.
Liver toxicity.
Okay, very good. Look at that second one.
Weight gain because they have they eat a lot, right? So
remember in chapter 62 that the treatment for Addison's led Cushing's syndrome, and then also the treatment for Cushing's disease led to Addison's. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, same exact concept here. So if we give this patient antithyroid medications, by the term itself, antithyroid, they will suppress or kill the thyroid gland. So these two thionamides work slightly differently, but both are have their own side effects. Some patients may be not good candidates for surgery, so they may be on thionamides for a long time. But typically, as long as the patient is otherwise healthy and no other contraindications, they'll only be on the thionamides for a short period of time, just in preparation for surgery. Here's the other drug, SSRI. This is typically only used for surgical preparation. Local solution of SSKI is not used long-term. They are used together with the thionamides, but because of how this drug works, the idea here in SSKI is, since there is no other gland in the body, just like with, if you remember in radioactive iodine, when we gave it PO, how sure were we that it will show up on the thyroid scan? The answer is because no other gland, no other tissue in the body uses iodine. It's only the thyroid glands. And because they are the only ones who consume it, therefore, if you give it a... I'm trying to explain the rationale of giving iodine, right? Because if you look under the causes, under etiology, one of the causes listed there was actually high intake of iodine-rich foods. So if you eat a lot of seafood, nothing else, you're exposed to a lot of iodine, you could develop hyperthyroidism. Another cause is, could be, let's say you're drinking, I don't know, betadine. Okay, so you like the taste of betadine, you drink it every day, or you paint your skin with it. Okay, so you shower and use it as a lotion, right? Let's say you like Donald Trump's color and you're using betadine to get his color. All right. So that is still iodine in regardless of the form. So that's actually one of the causes of hyperthyroidism. And yet you see here, we're actually giving them potassium iodide, which has iodine in it. The rationale behind it is if you flood the iodine, this is the theory, by the way, there's really no definite explanation, but the theory is, if you flood the thyroid glands with a lot of iodine at one time, it will actually suppress its activity, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The same concept as, let's say, if I give you a lot of food at one time, will you continue to eat?
No.
No, right? So it's the same idea of giving SSKI. So if you give the thyroid gland a lot of iodine at one time, it will actually stop eating it. It will kind of say, well, you don't know what, I don't want anymore.
Okay? It'll be desensitized almost.
Yeah, kind of like that. It's the same idea. So that's how they came up with this therapy of giving SSKI to hyperthyroidism. But the purpose here for SSKI is really for preparation for surgery. And because we give it with thionamides, here's the guide that should be given 1 hour after a thionamide has been given. What's the rationale? Thank you for reading, Miss Lamo.
Because initially the iodine agents can cause an increase in the production of thyroid hormones. Giving a thymide first prevents this initial increase in thyroid hormone production.
Okay, I forgot to mention how the thionamides work. Okay, thionamides work by blocking the iodide binding in the thyroid gland. Meaning, if you're exposed to iodine, you're not the thionamide will prevent iodide binding. So therefore, in patients being prepared for surgery, you give the thionamide first and then the SSKI next. And here's a alert, having too much iodine. Here's a warning about methimazole having a category X. It can cause birth defects. So, and what is the age of the women taking this drug? I mean, having hyperthyroidism?
They're fertile.
They are childbearing age. So therefore, what should be done before starting them on methimazole? Pregnancy test. And therefore, what would also be given to the woman while on methimazole?
Birth control.
All right, how many?
Two forms.
All right, two forms. So two condoms?
No.
No. Condom and pull out.
All right. No, two forms. Okay? So birth control plus condom. Okay, so two methods. Because this is a category X. You really don't want to be pregnant while on it. You have no idea what your child will look like. All right. So about 2 weeks here. So the iodine preparation is given about 2 weeks before surgery. In between, because of all the symptoms you saw in chart 62.1, the patient has tachycardia, they have the tremors, they have, they feel so nervous, they have hypertension, so you give medications for those. Most common, they'll be on beta blockers, but the type use is only propranolol. We typically don't use metoprolol, okay? So of all the beta blockers, it's propranolol. It's really used for the shaking, the tremors that result from hyperthyroidism. In fact, for all other disorders that have shaking as a symptom, patients are also put on propranolol for the same purpose. So beta blockers are given for the symptoms. So mainly diaphoresis, anxiety, tachycardia, palpitations. But remember that the beta blockers have no effect on the disease itself. So simply symptomatic. So this is the therapy I mentioned earlier. So RAI-123 is used for diagnostic purposes. It can also be used for therapeutic purposes. You can use internal radiation. So we talked about radiation therapy in chapter 22, two semesters ago. So this is the internal radiation type. So this one is either given orally or IV. Most common is oral. So this is 131. And here's the warning. Again, can't be used if the woman's pregnant. So the idea here is because, again, the thyroid glands are the only organs in the body that will absorb or use iodine. So therefore, if you give it, then the only organ damage here is the thyroid gland, which is what we're trying to do anyway. However, it is radioactive, and this is now internal radiation. So therefore, can it enter body fluids?
Yes.
Yes. However, however low the radiation is, okay, so the patient typically is about radioactive for about a month. Okay, so for the whole time, you have to follow radiation precautions in chart 63-4. This was tested already in chapter 22, third semester, but since this is here again, so we will test it again. And you can read at the grading level of 12th grade or higher. So I'll let you read these. Please do it on your own. When reading these, just bear in mind that anything wet coming out of the patient, be it your saliva, semen, urine, feces, vaginal secretions, what else is wet? Yeah, that's about it. Sweat typically doesn't cause any harm. There's, in fact, I don't know. Maybe fungal infections can be transmitted through sweat, but yeah, pretty much nothing else. HIV is not in sweat, right? Yeah, all other body fluids are radioactive here. So that's why they put here no sharing toothbrushes and selecting foods that have no bone. Okay. I initially thought this was ridiculous until I met a lawyer whom my wife worked with before, and we were at dinner one time, and it was a place with chicken wings, okay? And then, so one of the guys on our table was one of those that only eat the center and don't bother eating the cartilage and some meat at the tip of the chicken wing. Mm-hmm. So this chick asked the guy and says, "Are you gonna eat that?" And of course the guy said no. And then he didn't expect her to pick it up and finish it, which is exactly what she did. So she picked up this guy's leftover bones on his, from his plate, and then sucked it out clean. So I guess some people do. So for that person, you should make sure you don't expose her to radiation, I guess. All right, so we prepared the patient for surgery. We gave the patient SSKI or local solution for 2 weeks before surgery. We also did the antithyroid drugs. So the thyroid gland at this time now is very almost euthyroid, almost close to normal. Okay, so now the patient can have surgery. Somebody had a question? Okay. All right, so depending on the patient's condition, if it's going to be total thyroidectomy or only subtotal thyroidectomy. If it's total, just like with adrenalectomy, it depends. Is it bilateral adrenalectomy or unilateral thyroidectomy? So if it's total, the whole thyroid gland is gone, then the lifelong thyroid hormone replacement is applicable. If it's only partial or subtotal, then of course the hormone replacement will only be for a couple years in order for the remaining gland to catch up and compensate, and then they'll take them off. So just like in Cushing's disease, it depends on, did you take out the whole thyroid or did you only take out part of it? So if it's total thyroidectomy, then of course the patient now has hypothyroidism. If it's subtotal, then their only hypothyroid state is temporary for probably 1 or 2 years. Any question on that?
Professor, if there is a total or the subtotal, because there's only one thyroid gland, right? So I don't know. Because if it's adrenal, it's like two, because we have two adrenal glands on the both the kidneys.
Yeah, it's possible to remove only part of it. Just like, you know, you can only, it's possible to remove part of your liver. There are also lobes in the thyroid gland.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. So we described it earlier about pre-op preparation. So here's the rest of it. Are we recording? Yes, okay. So here are your preparations. So we gave iodine preparations along with antithyroids. Remember to give which one first, thionamide or iodine preparation first?
Thionamides.
The thionamide 1 hour after you give the iodine. And these, we already said, will be given, the patients will be given propranolol for that. We also kind of prepare the patient physically, because remember what was their health and nutrition state here before surgery, because they're in a hypermetabolic state, so are they in positive or negative nitrogen balance here?
Negative
nitrogen balance, so they need to be at least close to positive as possible. So we give them a high protein, high carb before surgery to prepare them for surgery, because what could happen? Remember, surgery is stressful. What could be triggered during surgery here? Which is the equivalent of adrenal crisis in Cushing's. What's the complication that could result here?
Thyroid storm.
Okay, thyroid storm. Please take note of the complications post-op. Here, because the incision is horizontal across the neck, so it's like somebody's slitting your throat, because that's literally what the doctor is doing. The structures around the thyroid gland are the trachea and the larynx. So during excision of the thyroid gland, there could be damage to both structures, in addition to the parathyroid glands, which are attached to the thyroid glands. So we have 4 parathyroid glands attached to the thyroid gland. So all these 3 structures can potentially be damaged. 1, the larynx, 2, the trachea, and 3, the parathyroid glands. We'll skip the operative procedure because we are not tested on intra-op. So let's go to post-op. So since our surgery, again, involved structures around the thyroid glands, namely the larynx, the trachea, and the parathyroid glands. So let's monitor the potential effects of the surgery has on these 3 collateral glands. First is vital signs, that's a given. Now because the airway is our problem here, that's our priority. So place the patient in a semi-Fowler's position. No neck extension, meaning the neck should be in a neutral position. We don't want them putting any strain on the incision, because now once you have bleeding in there, then there's only one place the bleeding could go, into the airway. Damage to the parathyroid gland. I mentioned earlier, there's only one hormone produced by the parathyroid gland, which is the parathyroid hormone, or simply called the parathormone. Its one purpose is to increase calcium level. So therefore, if you injure the parathyroid glands, it will cause a decrease in parathormone, leading to hypocalcemia. So that
is... So, Professor, if they have a total thyroidectomy, are they on like lifetime medications for calcium balance?
Yes, both.
As well, or...
Yeah, they will most likely end up with both the thyroid hormone replacement as well as calcium replacement also. For like, it takes a very skilled doctor to leave the parathyroid glands intact. Most like, I mean, they're so tiny, that it's almost impossible not to take them out when you have total thyroidectomy. The other is the monitoring for damage to the laryngeal nerve, and then finally watching for thyroid storm. Bleeding obviously you have surgery, so yes, it's bleeding can occur both during and then after the surgery. During, because of course you have a very hyperactive thyroid gland, the blood supply to it is quite high. That's why we gave iodine and thionamide before surgery. And continue to watch for bleeding. Now they have a anyway, if you see it, with regards to bleeding, oh, right here. So look always at the back of the neck, because the bleeding may not pool in front. So by gravity, bleeding or blood will always pool in the back. Okay, so check the neck dressing for signs of bleeding. There is a JP drain left in place. It's common. And here is your sign for respiratory distress, stridor, meaning the incision or the tissues around the incision are so swollen that they may compress the airway.
Professor, quick question.
Yep.
If there is a bleeding after the surgery, what would be the intervention then?
They go back to OR.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the same thing as, remember, tonsillectomy?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Was it last semester?
Yes, tonsillectomy.
Yeah, tonsillectomy. Yeah. If there's bleeding, you have to take them back to the OR. Okay, here's a critical rescue alert. You can read, right? So thank you. Management of hypocalcemia, which is inevitable. If the patient develops hypocalcemia post-op, then these are your interventions. Calcium gluconate or calcium chloride IV. Take note of the laryngeal nerve damage, which is manifested in a hoarseness or a weak voice. Management of thyroid storm. Again, the key symptoms, as already mentioned earlier, is the severe hypertension, tachycardia, and fever. We have actually a chart for that because this is an emergency. Chart 63-5. Airway first, and then we give methimazole, the antithyroid, and then the iodide solution. Okay, so this one, and then 1 hour later, give the SSKI. The propranolol, obviously these are for those patient symptoms, the tachycardia and the diaphoresis, anxiety, etc. Glucocorticoids are given. They have to be on a cardiac monitor because of the cardiac complications that result from the severe hyperthyroidism event. And the others are symptomatic. So cooling blankets because of the severe hyperthermia that could result. Any questions so far? All right, so this section here is now managing the rest of the symptoms of the patient. So I mentioned about photophobia. So on top of the artificial tears, the patients who cannot close their eyelid, we will have to tape them gently, okay? Or use eye patch, that's also acceptable. Here's a option in severe cases, they will be given steroids. That's still for the eye and vision problems. And because the treatment for hyperthyroidism could lead to hypothyroidism, then you teach the patient those signs. Definitely, if it's total thyroidectomy, then the patient becomes hypothyroid. In anti-thyroid therapy using thionamides and SSKI, it's also possible. And that's it. Let's take a break. Come back at 5:30. So let's do hypothyroidism this time. So obviously one of the causes here is treatment for hyperthyroidism. So hypothyroidism is now the complete opposite of hyperthyroidism. I already showed you the difference earlier. So we have either primary hypothyroidism or it could be secondary, which is caused by a hypopituitary disorder. Some causes here could be, this is under primary. It could be caused by a decreased intake of iodine, meaning you live in, you know, a place where you can't access seafood, or you just don't like those foods. Okay. Chart 63-6, these are the chart 63-6, these are the key features of hypothyroidism. So the complete opposite of hyperthyroidism. I let you compare those side by side. Just go through that. So if you had a very hyperactive, very jittery person in hyperthyroidism, this one you have the slowest moving, the most apathetic people, no energy, no interest, okay, always sleepy. Instead of gaining weight, instead of losing weight, they gain weight. They have decreased appetite, but yet they still gain a lot of weight. So this is a typical picture of myxedema. This is a complication of hypothyroidism. The patient will have this appearance. They'll have the enlarged tongue. And because the lung is now enlarged, they can't keep it in their mouth. So it tends to protrude like this. So this is the equivalent of thyroid storm in hyperthyroidism. This one obviously is in myxedema, in hypothyroidism called myxedema. The coma here is actually a late sign. It's not the one of the key features of myxedema. Myxedema is a later sign. Here are our causes of hypothyroidism. So I mentioned surgical removal as a treatment for either hyperthyroidism or from thyroid cancer. It can also be autoimmune. So we had Graves' disease in hyperthyroidism. So in hypothyroidism, we have Hashimoto's thyroiditis, which is the autoimmune form. Congenital, meaning you're born with one, or could be cancer. And here are other causes. It could be drug-induced, which can be temporary, therefore. And as I already mentioned, secondary would be a pituitary problem or any other neurologic disorder. Same as hyperthyroidism, this disorder affects women of childbearing age, although not always. We already did this signs and symptoms under the charts, this part. The laboratory assessment, we had it under hyperthyroidism, so please review that. So it will be the opposite. So here you will have low T3, low T4, low free T4, as well as a high TSH this time, at least with respect to primary hypothyroidism. And then the TSH, I said high, right? Yeah, TSH will be high in primary hypothyroidism, and then it will be low in secondary, which is a pituitary disorder. Let's go straight to management now. As highlighted here, respiratory failure is the most common cause of death in myxedema. Because remember, all the muscles will be weakened. Keep in mind that your diaphragm is also a muscle. Here's another warning. With any hypothyroid patient, you should be cautious about giving any CNS depressant. All sedatives are, of course, CNS depressants. So whenever you're giving benzodiazepines, for instance, or opioids, always consider the patient's hypometabolic state, meaning because they have a slower metabolism of drugs, drug levels therefore tend to accumulate in the bloodstream. Okay, and then if you see later, let's say 4 hours later, you still have you don't see any effect on the patient, and then you might be tempted to, okay, let's give another dose. Give it a second thought before you do that, because it could be because of the slower drug metabolism in these patients. Not that it didn't have any effect on the patient. So if you had hypertension and tachycardia as your cardiovascular concerns in hyperthyroidism, so you will have bradycardia and hypotension here in hypo. So always think about decreased cardiac output here. The only treatment here, unlike in hyperthyroidism where you had several, you had radioactive iodine, you had thionamides, you had SSKI, all part of antithyroid medications. Here, there's only one, because you are simply replacing the missing hormone, which is your thyroxine. And we will give it in the form of levothyroxine. The guideline for starting it, though, is this one. We always start low and go slow. Again, we always start the dose low and we go slow. By going slow, meaning as we increase the dose, we should do so slowly. Doctors are aware of that, because if the patient has cardiovascular symptoms, it might result in severe hypertension or even cardiac arrest if we start at a really high dose. So here's the rationale here, starting at too high of a dose, and increasing the dose too rapidly can cause these cardiac complications. In myxedema coma, because these patients are already usually unconscious at that point, and management therefore of myxedema coma will involve IV administration of levothyroxine, because obviously they can't take it by mouth anymore. These are the patient's usual symptoms. Please always monitor them for the development of myxedema, especially if they're getting more sleepy than usual. They're tired, more tired than usual. Also with starting therapy. So don't expect the patient's symptoms of hypothyroidism to disappear right away. Typically, as stated here, it takes about 2 weeks before you see any changes, because the thyroid levels have to build up in the blood. So that doesn't happen overnight. Plus the doctor, again, cannot increase the dose right away. So if we end up having the dosing too low, we typically don't increase it that high. Again, the guidance is go start low, go slow. So for some people, it may be longer than 2 weeks before you see any improvement, because the doctor still needs to change the doses, because typically we do it, let's say, if we do it 2 weeks at a time, That means we put the patient on that dose for 2 weeks, draw blood, and then watch them again for another 2 weeks. So it could be longer for some patients. These are your consequences from myxedema. Again, coma here, just because it's listed on top, isn't your first symptom. This actually is a late symptom. So your other concerns here are respiratory failure, hypotension, hyponatremia, hypothermia, and hypoglycemia. You may say, why hypoglycemia? Well, think of it as all your organs are slow, meaning that will include the pancreas. So if the pancreas is slow, has a slow function, therefore it will also secrete low levels of insulin. Or generally speaking, just the decreased metabolic rate. Okay, so the patients won't be able to process their nutritional intake normally. Okay, so they'll have hypoglycemia, which is the opposite of what you saw in hyperthyroidism. So here's the item on shock. So that again is your number one concern. Shock is a state, not a disease. So this can result from myxedema of severely low blood pressure. And because this is also life-threatening, just like thyroid storm, here is your chart on the best practice for managing myxedema coma. So after you establish ABC, here is the IV levothyroxine. Okay, because the patient has hypoglycemia, here's your dextrose. Steroids will also help increase your sugar. The patient has low temperature, so they will have cold intolerance, so give them warming blankets. And because they're unconscious, so institute aspiration precautions. And that's about it. Hypothyroidism is shorter because there's only one therapy. You give levothyroxine, that's it. But just like in hyperthyroidism, wherein the treatment could lead to the other problem, the same thing here in hypothyroidism. So you may start here, and then we could end up having too much of the hormone. Plus, one question for you guys. Do your hormone needs remain the same all the time throughout your life?
No. They change with age.
Right. Age will affect it. Developmental needs also affect it. So let's say you're okay with this dose, and let's say you're at 188 micrograms daily. What will happen to that during examination week or finals week?
Increase.
Okay, your needs will increase. What about if you get pregnant?
It's increase.
It will also increase. What if you get old?
Sorry?
Once you get old, let's say you started at 188 micrograms at 30 years old. Now you're 65.
It increases.
It increases as you get older?
Increases. Yeah.
Increase, I think. Because any other vitamins and everything.
What happens to your metabolic rate as you
get older? Metabolic rate is decreased. So maybe it decreases.
Okay, so our hormone needs decrease as we age. So therefore, that's what I mean by your hormone needs never stay the same. So can you be put on one dose and then see you later?
No, you have to keep on.
Patient needs to be monitored periodically. So every few months, your T3, T4, TSH, or basically your thyroid panel has to be evaluated every few months. And here is your, related to what I just said earlier. So aging will affect your metabolic rate. Your metabolic demands change. So do your metabolic needs. Okay. Yes, go ahead.
I have a quick question about the hypothyroidism and hyperthyroidism, about the mental status. What is the changes in mental status? What is the difference in the mental status in both the conditions?
Between hypo and hyper?
Yes.
Your patient in hyperthyroidism, if you remember, there was emotional lability.
Yes.
It's very unpredictable. They change from one spectrum to the other. Here in hypothyroidism, it mostly remains the same. Like they have, they're lethargic. They have more of a disinterested mood. You know, they're lethargic. They're drowsy. Go ahead.
Okay. The confusion and the disorientations are mostly in the hypo.
Yeah, that's more found in hypo.
Okay, thank you, Bruce. Okay.
This paragraph here is the practical teaching you can give the patient to recognize whether or not their level thyroxine dose is too high or too low. Thank you for reading, Ms. Williams. Or Mr. Joseph.
Teach the patient to monitor himself or herself for therapy effectiveness. The two easiest parameters to check are need for sleep and bowel elimination. When the patient requires more sleep and is constipated, the dose of replacement hormone may be needed to increase. When the patient has difficulty getting to sleep and has more bowel movements than normal for him or her, the dose may need to be decreased.
Okay, makes sense, right? It's a very good practical teaching you can give the patient. And that's about it. We're not covering thyroiditis. It's similar to hyperthyroidism. And for thyroid cancer, that's already cancer, which was managed in chapter 22. Let's finish up with the parathyroid disorders. Let's start with hyper this time. So this is really fast because the only problem here is your calcium levels. So obviously in hyperparathyroidism, you have hypercalcemia. In hypoparathyroidism, you have hypocalcemia. So our manifestations and interventions here are related to hypercalcemia and hypocalcemia. So let's begin. Causes. Usually either from the parathyroid gland itself, or it could be a thyroid disorder. Another is for hypo, same thing. It could be a thyroid problem, or it could be a parathyroid problem. Signs and symptoms, like I said, are all related to calcium levels. So what will a patient with hypercalcemia look like? For purposes of exam one, I will only get the signs and symptoms in this chapter. So from 62 regarding sodium and potassium level disorders, I'll get it from 62. And for 63, hyper and hypocalcemia, signs and symptoms, I'll grab the questions from chapter 63 as well. So you have a pattern here. So this is high calcium. So that means calcium is high in the blood, it's low inside the cell. So obviously there is an opposite trend here. So look at GI problems, for instance. GI, your calcium levels are high in the blood, low inside the GI cells. So therefore what will happen to the And you know that as cell, electrolytes are excitatory to cells, so do you have enough calcium to excite the GI tract?
No.
Inside the cell? No. So look at your GI peristalsis. It's low. As a result, you have nausea, vomiting, constipation, and even... that's already constipation. Yeah, so lower bowel movements. Here is a comparison between hyper and hypoparathyroidism. Calcium and phosphorus are always opposite. You'll see this later when we get to the teaching regarding diet. Same thing for in hypoparathyroidism. the numbers I'll use for the exam are only for calcium and phosphorus. Well, include magnesium as well. So these three, these first three here, I'll use the numbers on the exam. So data, let's say it's a select all and apply, for instance, I'll use these numbers here. For calcium, it just memorize your total calcium. No need for the ionized. The difference between the two is calcium, total calcium is the whole calcium in the body. Ionized calcium is only the referring to the free calcium. You know, the calcium that's Ca++. This is the calcium that goes in and out of the cell, which is only your free calcium. So we were really concerned about the total calcium, meaning these are both calcium in the blood as well as calcium in the bone. Intervention. So how do we help a patient who has hypercalcemia? First is diuretic and hydration. It may sound counterproductive because you're giving a diuretic and giving large amounts of fluid at the same time. Not really. Diuretic upon administration will take about 30 minutes to an hour before they work. However, hydration therapy will work right away. And this is not only PO. Okay, these are large volumes of fluid. So you give large fluid boluses of saline and then you give diuretics at the same time. So this will increase the excretion of calcium. So the effect obviously of your fluid boluses here is hemodilution. So it will drop calcium levels through hemodilution until your diuretic sets in, which is now going to eliminate the calcium. So both are given, not one or the other. Drug therapy. So we have several here in order to, one, excrete calcium. The others will stop the breakdown of calcium from the bone. And three, the third group will be to increase the deposition of calcium back into the bone. So we have such drugs are, you can choose between cinacalcet. You also see that, saw that given to patients on dialysis, because this is a common problem in hemodialysis patients. They have hypercalcemia. No, sorry, it's the opposite. They have hypocalcemia, sorry. So forget that part. Okay. Other drug therapy are phosphates. Obviously, this is the opposite. Okay, so you give phosphate, then that will decrease calcium. You give calcium, that will decrease phosphate. However, IV phosphates are only given when you really need to rapidly drop your calcium. Calcitonin, which is naturally produced by your thyroid glands, can also be given. There is a synthetic form of calcitonin. In all of these conditions, because we have cardiac anomalies resulting from hypercalcemia, so put the patient on a monitor. Because the patient's serum calcium is high, that means where did this calcium come from? Did they take a handful of calcium supplements that caused the hypercalcemia? Obviously not. So. Right, so in hyperthyroidism, this calcium came from the bone. So therefore, the reason why you have hypercalcemia is because there was increased parathyroid hormone, which increased the breakdown of calcium from the bone. That's how we ended up with hypercalcemia. So it's important to prevent injury. So if you compare this to Cushing syndrome, which the patient also has osteoporosis, and therefore are prone to fractures, the same thing for your hyperparathyroid patients. Surgical management. So we remove the parathyroid glands because they are secreting too much parathyroid hormone. However, this is fast because we don't have to do this again, because this is the same surgery we just did earlier on a patient with hyperthyroidism. So pre and post-op care will be the same because this is the same parathyroid gland we are removing. So same complications after surgery, namely bleeding, hypocalcemia, and airway compromise. Any question on hyperparathyroidism?
Just one. Professor, how the hypercalcemia can cause the constipation?
It's really, again, based on how the electrolyte excites the cells. Okay, so it's like this. All electrolytes are either positively charged or negatively charged, right?
Yes.
So they enter and leave the cell. So in the case of calcium, for instance, in cardiac, which we'll talk about on for exam 3. So we have calcium channels in your cells, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Particularly in the case of your vessels. So they, if you have calcium channels opening and closing and then calcium entering and leaving the cell. So if you close the channel, because the vessels are also muscles, correct? So if yes. Calciums are entering the vessels, then they will cause vasoconstriction. So that's why you have drugs called calcium channel blockers, specifically blocking those calcium channels. So if you close them, so therefore calcium cannot enter, vessels cannot contract. They cannot constrict, thereby causing vasodilation. So let's look at the cells now. So look at here your GI cells. So the same exact concept. If your calcium is higher inside in the bloodstream, therefore, what is the level inside the cell?
Low.
They are lower. So can your peristalsis be still normal? Because you need calcium in order for those cells to contract and function. However, they are not entering the cell because they are lower there, higher in the bloodstream. So what happens to peristaltic activity?
It decreases.
Lower, leading to nausea, vomiting, constipation.
Okay. Sounds good.
Let's go now to hypoparathyroidism. So this is the exact same problem, only the opposite occurs. So now you have hypocalcemia. One thing in common is whether your calcium is high or low, you will have brittle bones. Okay? Either way you look at it, hyper and hypocalcemia patients both have risk for fractures in this condition. Regardless of the type, whether it's iatrogenic, idiopathic, hypomagnesemia, the patient still has hypocalcemia. You remember the word iatrogenic, right?
Iatrogenic.
In fundamentals of nursing, meaning these are conditions that result from, these are unintended consequences of either a test or a surgery. Yeah? For instance,
yes.
After this one, for instance, after a total thyroidectomy, did we intend for the parathyroidism to occur?
No,
we didn't intend that, but it occurred as a result of treatment for another condition. Idiopathic, from the word idiot. So we don't know. What's causing this type of hypoparathyroidism. And whenever we don't know, we usually blame it on a autoimmune cause. And as you saw on the chart, so if there are opposite relationship between calcium and phosphorus, there is a direct relationship between calcium and magnesium. So if you have hypomagnesemia, you most likely will have hypocalcemia. Let's look at the signs and symptoms. So do the opposite in from hyperparathyroidism. So here, I'll just show you the they didn't mention GI symptoms here.
Diarrhea now, maybe.
Okay. But I know, yes, it will be the opposite. So here we have, instead of having high calcium in the bloodstream, this time we have low. So if we, now we have low calcium in the blood, higher calcium inside the cells, and higher intracellular calcium. It will therefore cause a hyperparastatic activity. So instead of having nausea, vomiting, constipation, now you have diarrhea. You have hyperactive bowel sounds. Now you have higher calcium levels intracellularly, so they will lead to muscle cramping, muscle spasms of the hands, feet, and even cause seizures, because calcium is also high inside the neurons in the brain. Mm-hmm. Interventions. So here we have low. So we're not trying to get rid of calcium here. We're trying to increase calcium. So your interventions, therefore, are supplementation. So we give calcium, vitamin D, and magnesium supplementation. So same pattern as in hypothyroidism. So we didn't have the hormone, so we give the hormone. This time we don't have enough calcium, so we give the patient calcium as well as all other drugs that may increase either the absorption of calcium or the increased deposition of calcium. So PO or IV, if the cause is from vitamin D deficiency, then we give calcitriol, which is a synthetic, this is vitamin D, calcitriol. This is the dosing for your calcium, I mean vitamin D, 50,000 to 400,000 units. Calcium in itself is either 500 milligrams up to 2,000 milligrams a day. Please take note of the divided doses. You cannot give this one time. So they have to be given, if it's 2 grams, then they'll have to be given 4 times a day. So the safe dosing is about 500 milligrams per dose. And just like in levothyroxine treatment, which is your hormone for hypothyroidism, stress the same teaching here in hypoparathyroidism, that the replacement for calcium, for vitamin D, etc., are lifelong. Okay. And please read this part here, which most of us may find, huh? Thank you for reading, Miss Jordan. Oh, wait a minute, is Miss Jordan here? Yeah? Or is she evening? Never mind. Thank you, Miss Arias.
Which part do you want me to just highlight it?
The diet, yeah.
Milk, yogurt, and processed cheeses are avoided because of their high phosphorus content.
Right. That's surprising, right? Because normally when we say high calcium, that's the first things that come to mind, correct? That's what we would teach a patient. But in this case, because we don't want sources that also have high phosphorus, it would be counterproductive. Only in this case, though, only for hypoparathyroidism. All right. And that's it. Any questions?
So the next time we meet, it's exam 1, right?
Yes. That-